honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 130, the first in a conversation with a monk about monkhood and the relevance of the Dhamma to the world. But first we will make the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. And in English, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha.
Friends, what is the purpose and final goal of the noble life? The Blessed Buddha once said, because if those of other sects and of other beliefs should ask you this question, friends, for what purpose is a noble life lived under the ascetic Buddha Gautama? When being asked that question, you should answer them in exactly this very way. It is, friends, for the fading away of greed, lust and desire, for the breaking out of the mental prison of addiction, for the uprooting of the ingrown evil latent tendencies, for the direct experience of the supremely good method, for the destruction of the mental fermentations, for the enjoying of the fruit of certainty and total freedom, for the sake of definite knowledge and penetrating vision, for the sake of final nibbana without trace of clinging. It is for this purpose that this noble life is lived under the Blessed Buddha. Then, bhikkhus, if those of other sects should ask you, but what is the method for attaining final nibbana without clinging? Being asked that, you should answer them thus. Friends, there is indeed a method. There is certainly a way for reaching final nibbana without any clinging. It is indeed exactly this noble eightfold way. Right view, sammaditti. Right motivation, samma sankappa. Right speech, samma vaccha. Right action, samma kammanta. Right livelihood, samma ajiva. Right effort, samma vajjama. Right awareness, samma sati. Right concentration, samma samadhi. This is the method. This is the way for entering the dimension of final nibbana without clinging. When asked this question, bhikkhus, you should answer those of other beliefs in this very way. What then is the fruit of the noble way? How does the noble eightfold way makes one noble? Having cultivated the noble eightfold way, a being might enter the stream which leads to nibbana. Such stream entra suttapanna is entirely freed from rebirth as animal, hungry ghost, angry demon, and the ultimate catastrophic destiny, burning hell being. Such noble one, such Arya, will be enlightened within 7 rebirths, either as a human or as a deva. The stream entra has eliminated all egoism, all belief in a person or a self is eradicated, all eye-making and all mind-making is gone. Abolished is all skeptical doubt in the complete perfect self-enlightenment of the Buddha, and removed is silly superstitious beliefs in any benefit of empowerment and empty rituals. Such noble one have by direct momentary experience touched and tasted deathless nibbana, and is therefore forever hereafter independent of any teacher. At this dream entry moment, right there and right then, as an internal light flash. Right view emerges from wrong view, and from all defilements as clear seeing. Right motivation emerges from wrong motivation as deliberately directing. Right speech emerges from wrong speech as kindly embracing. Right action emerges from wrong action as clever originating. Right livelihood emerges from wrong livelihood as full cleansing. Right effort emerges from wrong effort as enthusiastic exerting. Right awareness emerges from wrong awareness as alert establishing. Right concentration emerges from wrong concentration as non-distraction. Externally, this gotrabu, change of lineage, emerges from all symbols and conventions. This mental remodeling is an irreversible phase transition to the noble state. Path of Purification, Visuddhimagga, 681. Having cultured the Noble Eightfold Way even further, one might attain the state of a once returner, Sakadagami, who is reborn only as a lower god and then awakens in the next life, when he returns here to earth as a human being. Such fine noble friend has significantly reduced his sense desire and aversion. All bodhisattvas are Sakadagamis when they leave earth for the Tusita divine dimension, for the contented life they enjoy just before their last human rebirth and final supreme enlightenment. Having further refined the Noble Eightfold Way, a being attained the state of non-returner, Anagami, who is reborn in the higher fine material worlds, the pure abodes, where they may live for many eons and they attain Nibbana without ever returning to the human or lower divine worlds. Such noble one has entirely eliminated all sense desire and all aversion. Having fully perfected the Noble Eightfold Way, one awakens as an Arahant who is enlightened in this very life by elimination of all remaining mental defects, such as desire for fine form and desire for formlessness, the subtle conceit that I am, and any latent tendency to restlessness and all the remnants of ignorance. Such noble one enters at the moment of death the ultimate freedom, the supreme bliss, and the imperturbable peace of Nibbana without any trace of clinging left. Nibbana an upatisesa. The Blessed Buddha once said, "Bhikkhus, these eight things, when cultivated and refined, lead to the going beyond from this near shore right here to the far shore beyond all." What eight? Right view, Sammaditti. Right motivation, Sammasankappa. Right speech, Sammavacca. Right action, Sammagamanta. Right livelihood, Sammajiva. Right effort, Sammavajjhama. Right awareness, Sammasati. And right concentration, Sammasamadhi. These eight things, when cultivated and refined, lead into the going beyond from the near shore, right here, to the far shore beyond all imagination. The Welcome One, the Supreme Teacher, then added this: few humans cross to that sublime far shore, beyond all being. Mostly, people just run up and down along this barren bank. Those whose praxis is like this, even an exact Dhamma, will pass on beyond the state of death to stilled harmony, having left all the dark and evil doing. Any intelligence seeks luminous light by leaving this turmoil. by going forth into solitary, sweetly silent homelessness. Secluded from lust, he experiences an unworldly bliss. Owing nothing, the wise and clever man thereby cleans himself of all these mental pollutions and defilements. Mentally, highly evolved by the seven links to enlightenment, delighting in non-clinging and relinquishment of all, such luminous ones, having quenched all fermentation, are completely released, even right here in this world. That this noble eightfold way is the only method to cease all suffering. And what, bhikkhus and friends, is right view? It is, bhikkhus, knowing such is suffering. Such is the cause of suffering. Such is the ceasing of suffering. And knowing such is the way leading to the cessation of suffering. This is called right view. And what, bhikkhus and friends, is right motivation? Being motivated by withdrawal, by goodwill, and being motivated by utter harmlessness. This, bhikkhus and friends, is called right motivation. And what, bhikkhus and friends, is right speech? Refraining from any lying, from slandering, from scolding, and refraining from empty gossip. That is called right speech. And what, bhikkhus and friends, is right action? Refraining from all killing, from all stealing and cheating, and avoiding all sexual misconduct. This is called right action. And what, bhikkhus and friends, is right livelihood? Here, bhikkhus and friends, the noble deceiving, having given up all wrong livelihood, lives by right livelihood. This is called right livelihood. And what, bhikkhus and friends, is right effort? Here, bhikkhus and friends, once makes a decision, makes an effort, steps up energy, exerts the mind and strives to prevent the arising of unarising evil disadvantageous mental states. One makes a decision and strives hard to overcome any evil disadvantageous mental state that already have arisen. One makes a decision and strives to develop all yet unarising good advantageous mental states. And one makes a decision, makes an effort, stirs up energy, exerts the mind and strives to maintain and expand any advantageous mental state that already have arisen, not letting them fade away, growing them greater to the fulfilled perfection of development. This is called right effort. And what, bhikkhus and friends, is right awareness? Here, bhikkhus, one dwells considering the body as a group of mere form, alert, clearly comprehending and aware, thereby ending all worldly urge and trouble. One dwells considering feelings just as assigned reactions, alert, clearly comprehending and aware, thereby ending all worldly urge and trouble. One dwells considering mind and mentality just as ever-changing moods, alert and clearly comprehending and aware, thereby ending all worldly urge and trouble. And one dwells considering all phenomena only as shifting mental states, alert, clearly comprehending and aware, thereby ending all worldly urge and trouble. This is called right awareness. And what, bhikkhus as friends, is right concentration? Secluded from sensual desires, protected from any detrimental state, one enters and dwells in the first jhana, full of joy and pleasure born of solitude, joined with directed and sustained thought. Again, with the stilling and silencing of this directed and sustained thinking, one enters and dwells in the second jhana, calmed and assured unification of mind, in joy and pleasure, now born of concentration, which is empty of all thought and thinking. Again, friends, with the fading away of joy, one dwells in equanimity, just aware and clearly comprehending. Still feeling bodily pleasure, one enters upon and remains in the third jhana, regarding which the noble ones declare, in aware equanimity, one dwells in happiness. Again, friends, with the leaving behind of both pleasure and pain, as with the prior fading away of both joy and sorrow, one enters and dwells in the fourth dhyana, a serene mental state of still, open, and completely clear awareness, purified by the equanimity of neither pain nor pleasure. This is my concentration. That bhikkhus is called the way leading to the ceasing of all suffering. That bhikkhus is called the way leading to the ceasing of all suffering. The Noble Eightfold Way. Thank you.
Coming up here along the coast in this wonderful place where Bande Dhammakavesi, which is originally from Sri Lanka, but have stayed for a number of years in UK, and then decided to become a monk later in his life. How old would you become a monk?
48.
And I was also 40. So we have almost a parallel career by having a lay life first with some education, and then decided to become monkhood. So what actually made you decide to become a monk?
But I would imagine first of all would be the association of other monks, especially a monk called Venerable Sila Gavesi, who visited the UK in 2000 and continued association with him made me see how exhausted I was earning money. But more than that, trying to spend the money I've earned, trying to be happy with the outcome. So I think that is the most fundamental nature. Though that would have been the first reason. Is it the reason to walk away? Don't think so. I think it was more about the use of robes, use of a patra, the following of the vinaya to go on pindapatha. And all of the things associated with this with this liberation to become a monk and to live like a monk, to experience this freedom of nirodha or of vimukti was since cultivated within.
Nirodha, I can just explain, means ceasing. So it's a kind of ceasing of the whatever perception or feeling you have as a layperson, huh?
Yeah.
So it was problems regarding this economical issues that there was in your lay life that propelled you, kind of like a form of dukkha, seeing dukkha, that propelled you into monkhood, and then at the same time as a friendship with a monk.
More than economical issues, it was about the result of spending money earned and not being satisfied or be able to satisfy other people with.
Yes. Yeah. So it this is a, I think, very common issue also for in all for lay people out there, and but in particular for monks. I can say I had something like the same, also being relatively wealthy as a medical doctor. You were an engineer, huh? So we had more or less what we could get, but still there was no satisfaction. And this is that you feel that there's no satisfaction. So then there's a kind of suffering, a kind of frustration, where you cannot say where it comes from, because the economy, the car, the villa, and the family, the children, they are already there. But still there is some dukkha, there's some dissatisfaction. And this goes for, of course, for all life, for all life. So Bande had friendship, and I can say to some extent, looking back at my own time, I also had friendship with an elderly monk, a senior monk of Tibetan origin, that showed me the way of the Dhamma, and thereby also reading the text and seeing other monks being inspired by other monks that have done the same. Then eventually I took the decision, but it took me, in my case, it took 5-7 years before from my first contact with the Dhamma and then to going forth. So it took some years. It was a gradual approach. It was not something easily I just did. Another thing I like to touch upon, what do you think is the main benefit that the Dhamma could bring the modern Western world?
Yes, Pandey. So, comparative to how I was introduced to the Dhamma, was given a chance to investigate two words. And these two words were, at the time when I met Silagapati Bante, I was diagnosed with many illnesses in the social world. And I was having medicines, tablets, name it, on a frequent basis. And when he saw me in such a state, he asked me, "Do you know that this medicine that you're taking, this medication you're taking, can also be treated in another way?" And he introduced these two words of meditation and medication. And he exposed these two words. And in these words, he said that medication has a word letter C and meditation has a letter T. And he then explained that to him, this medication C was something to do with chemicals, and in meditation, this letter T was to something to do with tranquility. And in both things, there is healing, there is cure. So I was very curious to find out whether tranquility could help me to free myself of whatever that I've been exposed as diagnosed and was going through, having to take so much of, you know, medicines and tablets and chemicals and the after effects of all those things. So this is how the suttas were introduced. So the Girimananda Sutta, justifying and explaining that it is this causation of sanya that causes these illnesses, and slowly that's how I was introduced into the Dhamma.
Mm. We discussed this issue later yesterday with physical disease and regarding, for example, heart disease caused by a high cholesterol. And then, as I understood it, you told me that you had a high cholesterol before you become a monk.
Yes.
And it was treated, but it was still high. And then you give up the medicines, become a monk, and then naturally it fell down. Is
exactly,
that correct?
Exactly. And I'm so aware of one word, and that was the word anxiety. Wanting to make sure that he was punctual at whatever transaction that was done, whether it's at work, whether it's at home. So punctuality was a huge part of life.
Hmm.
Next thing was about the word popularity. So in every role, he was always wanting to be popular with the others, looking for that something. So
when you say he, you mean yourself, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So to accomplish this, and when other people respond to you, react with you, if that popularity is not fed, when, you know, blame comes on board, there is something that is not pleasant.
Yes, certainly so.
Yeah. So this was felt so much, and the moment this monkhood was introduced into this life, momentarily this punctuality went away because the clock went away.
Watch.
No watch.
No calendar with all kinds of stuff.
So true. Nobody to influence you with a timer. Nothing needs to be done on a particular day. The outputs were very different. It was all personal and not towards another. So this transformation of what this journey of Nirvana, preliminary was so tasteful, so wonderful, so beautiful.
Sweet.
Yeah, exactly. So momentarily, this anxiousness towards another, to get feedback from another in role play was never a issue after you became a monk. I there was nothing that this Bhante had to perform or prove. As a monk, there is nothing that I have to prove to anybody. I just need to take my robes, my requisites, and just be with it.
You can say there's some education, of course. One is something that one has to know.
It comes one day.
So
the moment you take the robe, well, you must know how to be with the robe.
So you
find out how to be with the, you take a patra, you learn how to be with the patra. You give up your shoes, you learn how to be without a pair of shoes.
So, but coming back to, so you think the things that you have on a personal, and I also of course have experienced that this calm and this being bothered by the need or the dreaming up or the craving for punctuality, that you are basically on time, and also popularity, that you're popular among your colleagues and families and so on. Do you think this is the most important issue that one needs to give to the Western world in general?
But in a way, yes, because this convention that we live with in society, the economical world is driven by a clock. So punctuality plays a huge part. So those people who are weak with their punctuality will definitely have disciplinary issues in their vocational life.
Yeah, that should be 8 o'clock on work.
Exactly. Exactly. They can't be late for meetings. They can't be late with a transaction, with a project, with the outcome.
Yeah.
So it's driven in a way.
Yeah.
And that, in a way, feeds this naturality of popularity.
And
if you get a role, say with a project, and you complete it on time, naturally you are fed something to be popular with.
You're respected for it, and become popular among your colleagues and the boss and so forth.
And from there onwards, you are always that chosen person to accomplish something.
Yes.
So naturally, this journey causes you to be punctual, in that punctuality to perform in a way, so you get recognized and become popular with, and momentarily that then to maintain has a further issue. Because doesn't matter where you are in the social life, you're given a role. You have to play a role.
Sure.
So it doesn't matter what role you get, it doesn't matter what role you perform in that role, how you perform. It's a third person who always measures you. So this popularity that we look for, you know, the yasa, the word yasa, ayasa in the Asvastha Loka Dharma, this naturality of the word is about, in every sense, you're looking for your role to be recognized.
For praise, for fame.
Right. So those two come only if you're popular.
If
you're not popular, you don't get it.
No, sure.
So whoever who assesses you, there was a commitment to continue and to say yes, but never no. Because the moment you say no to the social world,
you become unpopular.
So within your family, within your working environment, whoever that you kept company with, there is this element where you never know how to say no to somebody. Enough is enough, you would not know. So we constantly get fed. Then a carrot is dangled in front of us, and we blindly follow this carrot.
By saying yes. Yes. To some extent, no is a very clear answer. It's also that you put up a border of what you will accept yourself. For example, whether one loses this popularity. I will not say the punctuality, but this popularity, I think, is okay that one can skip it. It's one of these eight worldly conditions that we're running after, praise and fame. So I think this is a good start to say, okay, if the Western world can learn to be without its social connections, and can be without being popular in this social connections, whatever this may be, then they will experience some freedom. Another issue you spoke about was peace or tranquility. So what role do you see us as monks and the Dhamma in general, the Sangha, in teaching? How do we get this tranquility that we experience ourselves, in particular in a setting like this and in the forest? How do we get this across to the Western world, who needs it badly?
Yes, Bhante. So first of all, one should start investigating your own self by asking the simplest of questions, as this Bhante was asked to ask. Do you get angry? And the answer was, yeah. And then the question is, why? Why do you get angry? And the next answer that naturally comes is that when things are not the way I want, first, not the way I want, I need, it's when my inside is disturbed. So now comes this understanding that what you need and what you want also falls into the category of things that you like. So from a Dhamma point of view, Vande, we have been groomed in the conventional society to have adequate needs, adequate wants. If you become a person in a family who doesn't have needs and wants, you become a discard, you get discarded in a way. For the mere reason, Vande, that others in the family cannot use you as a comparator. They can't compare with you because you have no needs. So they do not know whether they are right with their needs and wants. So naturally,
so they will feel estranged if you don't have any needs and they have a lot of needs, and they will feel kind of like a fear or feel uncomfortable with this person.
So true. So they do not know how to refer with you. So momentarily they make you a reference, and they naturally compare and compete with you. They don't admit this, but they do so. So you are encouraged to perform so they can compare and progress accordingly. So when this begins to happen in this society, the word promotion comes. Promotion. And promotion brings prosperity in the conventional world. So when you don't aspire to much promotion, other people who are looking for promotion and prosperity now suddenly feel that they backed the wrong horse.
So they will feel uncomfortable.
Exactly, Vande. And that causes a fear, that causes a doubt, that causes an aversion, that then creates this naturality of self-anger and anger towards other people. You are angry that you chose that way and followed it, and you are angry that they didn't perform the way that they set expectations on you.
However, I will say also, especially as a monk, this I felt especially in the rural setting, that when you come and eat only once a day, or if you tell in particular Westerners that you only sleep, let's say, 3 or 4 hours per day, then they feel it's true that they have difficulties with identifying and familiarizing with them, but I think they still feel some level of admiration, and also that they should be able to do the same. So they want to go the Dhamma way, but still have, because of this this issue with productivity and economics and so on, and they still have to fulfill whatever their boss say at job. So there comes a dichotomy there. But I think it's something that when monks go around, in particular in Buddhist countries, when you're seeing monks go Pindabat in the morning, and you see their calm demeanor, and that they only get what they eat, what they get in the bowl. Huh? They never go to a supermarket and pick and choose whatever their tongue likes to have. Then I feel inspired. And I think this is something, this simpleness of life that I experienced myself in the forest for a number of years, and a few ones, this modesty of life, this is something that we can bring to the West.
Yes.
And say, this is, why do we have all these needs? Why do we have all these cars? Why do we have this economy that is so blown up that everybody is running around?
Yeah.
In USA, it's especially in the city setting, now it's a big problem that people cannot sleep.
Right.
They cannot sleep because they have their mobile phone, and they're always connected to their mobile phone and to Facebook and so on. So they are always in contact with the entire samsara, in their job included. And so they never have any free space time.
Yeah.
And so it reminds me about a long period in my own forest monk life. There I would have two, if you look at my calendar, I had typically a month calendar on the wall of my Vamanakuti, and there I would put crosses in for each month if I should go to something that, like a birthday where they will serve the monks or whatever it could be. And there usually I will have 2 or 3 crosses per month. So there was only two or three obligations that I have to do per month. The rest of the something that I have to fill out my own time, and that will also be very responsible, seen from a Dhamma point of view, because I had the liberty to follow the noble life out there in the forest because of lay people donating funds and food and so on, also coming up and giving dana. So there you feel, though you have a lot of freedom and a lot of simplicity, still one is under obligation to do one's best, but one has a I would say more free choice to do something. And this has had a large significance for me personally, that I felt whatever I do, then it should make maximum meaning and purpose from a Dhamma point of view.
Yes.
So this was my obligation to find out in each moment, how could I use this time to the best of my ability to make progress towards Nirvana and to helping my noble friends in the noble life out there, also those who have supported me. How could I do that? And this I felt was, if you compare, for example, to a work job or to many, many obligations that you have in a lay life, they do not always make sense from a meaning point of view. Even in a medical profession, but in whatever profession, there will be a lot of routines, there will be a lot of circumstances, meetings, and so forth, that doesn't really make sense regarding the purpose that you are there.
So but comparing my social world that I used to be in comparison with this monkhood, one thing I see, the difference is that as a layperson, I had 24 hours. As a monk, I still have the same 24 hours. And that 24 hours has darkened hours, daylight hours. Though in the conventional world, there was an upbringing with tradition, with culture, with social circumstances to say how to spend the daylight hours, what to be responsible with, whom to be responsible for. And when it came to darkened hours, there was an element that you have to, you know,
eat supper, watch television, go to bed,
but
blah, blah, blah.
At the same time, there was the medical profession says that health is such that you have to have 8 hours of sleep minimum. So we, without even considering our personal circumstances, we were driven by the majority of medical and other sense of structure that our parents, our guardians, our teachers have
children,
followed,
wife,
have followed in a way.
Yeah.
So we, in turn, take it and give it to the society below us, saying that this is the right thing to do, this is a good thing to do, because it's a social thing.
Yeah. So it's a social convention that all this running around in this hamster wheel, this makes sense.
Exactly.
Because everybody else do it.
So true, Bhante, because you then go back to the Dhamma point of view and get exposed to Dhamma, where in the first sermon of the Buddha, he talks about the dukkha, and in the dukkha, he talks about the birth, the beginnings, and he talks that every beginning has its own ending, and everything that begins and ends has a duration in between. So, all of us who have started this journey that's waiting for the ending now has to still wait. Wait until it ends. So the question now gets asked, well, as a monk, how do you wait, right? And do you wait the way you used to as a lay person? So actually the dukkha is if you begin to investigate this waiting, because waiting also is a spending. Spending time, spending money, spending energy, spending knowledge, spending effort. It's just an ongoing spending. So, dukkha is not just explained in the word of suffering, but of all these elements of this expenditure that's burnt. Right?
However, for me personally, I think also for everyone who embarks on the noble way, this spending and this frustration that you have not reached the goal and that you still have to make an effort, this, when you have the goal of Nirvana, then it ultimately makes sense, because it does end there. When you reach Nirvana, there will be no more suffering. There will be no more effort. Then you can put down the burden irreversibly. This is a final goal, huh? This is the highest goal. While, let's say you stay in circulation, whether in this life or in this life, whether in lay life or in high divine life, then you're still, is even though you can satisfy your needs and then keep suffering or frustration at bay, is not an irreversible ending. It will come back because of impermanence, because of anicca.
Exactly.
It will come back, and thereby this going in circles, so to speak, I think become meaningless, because you cannot repair it, it will come back.
Right.
However much you satisfy your needs for sex or for meaning or for whatever, it will always come back. This urge will always come back, and then you have to make an effort again.
Yeah. So but now that we have been exposed to the Dhamma, and those in the conventional world are still following a format, following a situation that they are in, and that is seen as right, that's seen that the majority accepts and approves of their doing what they're doing, and their exhaustions haven't stopped.
No, truly right? Not.
So, one of the questions that I keep asking myself is that, as a lay person, how quickly did you get fed up with what you were doing? So even if you had a diamond, after a day, you already had the diamond.
A sport car.
Villa. So the value of whatever that you put is naturally something inside you is removing that value set.
Degrading.
Degrading.
Yeah.
So you naturally become bored. And this is one of the words that our Dhamma or the translations doesn't expose in a way. But if you ask many individuals, how bored are you? They'll say, I'm not bored at all. I said, good. So if you stop what you're doing, what will happen? And the natural answer is, well, I'll be bored then. So question asked is, are you doing what you're doing as a solution to boredom? And the answer is, maybe. So now when you look at this wider world, that is always inventing something, that's always an entrepreneurial, you know, solution that is there. Are these people actually doing this because they are bored? Do we actually need what they are inventing? No is the answer, because what is there is adequate. You know, it's economically present and it's adequate.
True.
You don't need new recipes anymore.
I think many in the Western world can follow this boredom. So they have tried, I think everybody has tried, to have a dream about getting something. It can be a car or a new job or a new house or a new living place. And then you get it. And then you think, now I will be eternally satisfied and happy. But then this boredom sets in after a while. So you say to yourself, now it doesn't satisfy me. So your passion for the object naturally, because of impermanence, goes away. And then the satisfaction in the object, whatever it may be, this also goes away.
Yeah.
And that's why I think I agree with you. That's basically the drive for not only for the Western world, but for the whole engineering, production, reinventing, all these kinds of things that we think we need, but which we don't need. And that we become very, very unhappy running after in this hamster wheel, because the economy that has to be put into this feeding this boredom with something new, something colorful, something tasteful, whatever it may be, new kind of music, new kind of tone, it is extraordinary.
Exactly, Bhante. So when you now take from a Dhamma point of view and the institutions we have, and look at the institution, Bhante, you would see that many of the institutions, even in the spiritual world, adopt certain activity that engages the society so they can occupy themselves in a way to overcome some of the boredom. So they come here.
The whole society structure is to get rid of this boredom,
right,
and stay in the world.
Exactly. So the second thing is, then where we have retreats. Yeah. So we encourage people to go on retreat, to meditate and spend some time and take some time out from this busy world. But still, if they are taken to a retreat and asked, write up your own timetable of how you're going to spend the day, they'll be lost. So they expect the teacher, the conductor, to set a timetable. What time should I wake up? 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock. Oh, good. Because at home, I wake up at 6. Here, I'm at retreat, so I'll wake up at 4 o'clock. What should I do? Oh, sitting? Okay, I do sitting, meditation, walking. So like this, they follow a routine given by somebody and they feel very obliged to do so and feel that they've retreated in a way. Actual retrievement for this Monday is if you ask them to come and put their own timetable, and then to learn to occupy their life for 24 hours.
By their own discrimination.
So true. Now you will begin to understand what that social life has done to condition that person.
So your argument is, even when they go to a meditation retreat, they're still in this prison of being a timetable, that the timetable has, and the meaning has to come from outside.
Yes,
they cannot fulfill it themselves, or they cannot find it in the Dhamma.
Yeah.
There has to become some certain framework, exactly. Because they've been in a framework, this hamster wheel, for all their lives,
right.
So they don't break out of
it. One example is that, you know, this Pandey has been with a young boy, 17-year-old boy, and he comes and says, I'm tired, around about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So I said, sleep? He says, where to sleep? So I asked him, do you want to sleep outside or do you want to sleep inside? He said, inside. You've chosen now, you only have a choice of inside. He said, then where to sleep? Oh, you could sleep on a chair, on a bed, on the ground. Where do you want to sleep? He said, on a bed. There are beds, go sleep. Then he wants to know which bed. This is how the society and the parenting has governed these children to think in this way. So I said, well, son, you can only go and sleep on a bed that is not occupied. So why don't you go inside, find a bed? If it's not occupied, you sleep. So he goes and uses his criteria, finds a bed that is not occupied, he sleeps. So 10 o'clock at night, he wakes up now. So he slept at 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
8 hours.
I didn't count. He comes and says, oh, I'm hungry. I said, well, son, there's a kitchen. And they're also tired. After 8 o'clock, they stop dinner and they sleep. Oh. So, then he says, why didn't you wake me up? I said, I'm a monk and I'm not supposed to be waking up children. I didn't become a monk to wake up children. Well, sleeping is okay. So he said, I want to go and sleep again. And he goes and sleeps again, wakes up at about 9 o'clock again and comes back and says, oh, I'm hungry again. He said, 8 o'clock, dinner, breakfast is finished now in the morning. So momentarily, within 24 hours, with no instruction, this boy tried to work out what he had to do to get into the routine of that environment so he can survive. But the social world is such that each person carrying some authority in a role chooses to start instructing these children.
Imposing
some rule sets, imposing some conditions, trying to influence other people's likes inside them. Many confusing circumstances that causes us to be so exhausted trying to perform to please
in this complicated social structure.
It is, Pandey.
I agree.
I wish society begins to see this, and I wish society is bold enough, at least a few in society are bold enough to say, I'm just going to go take a break from all this.
Another question from your personal, in your personal experience, if you should measure up, I know it's difficult to measure up like this, weigh it in total and say, where have I found most happiness, in my lay life or in my monk life? What would you say?
Oh, definitely, Pandey, the word happiness right? In the past, if there was a word called fun, wherever this mantra may have influenced to in have a result or outcome of fun, well, there was happiness there. Yeah, so
going in the pleasure park, the amusement park,
exactly. That social life that is there was always to go create fun, excitement.
Sure.
Have entertainment.
Yeah.
So therefore, the word happiness was present as long as there was fun, as long as there was occupation. Becoming a monk, no longer are you now feeding that element of fun.
No.
But now, Niramisa, you're working towards a different objective. So, all of that energy that was spent trying to create that environment of fun is no longer needed to be done. So, therefore, the word happiness can't be taken from that social life and compared with here.
Something entirely different.
It's different because now that Nispante understands a little bit about mindfulness and where the Buddha talks about sukha, dukkha, adukkama sukha and talks samisangva, niramisangva, now you begin to understand that naturally there is this pleasant, unpleasant and the neutrality, and this naturality is always forced or deliberated towards fun, and you have pleasant, unpleasant and the neutrality with fun. But at the same time, when you look at that niramisa, which is to do with the spiritual world.
Maybe we should just explain. There's this a very common expression in the Pali, niramisa and samisa. Samisa, literally speaking, means with the flesh or with meat. Usually with the flesh translated in the older translation. And niramisa is mean without flesh, without. What is the flesh in this regard? Yes, samisa is the flesh of samsara. So it's the pleasure you can get is the conventional pleasure that you can get in samsara. And if you take all this away, then you will have niramisa. It's a pleasure that is not of this world, is usually the translation. It doesn't come from any satisfaction that is connected with samsara. It doesn't come from any entertainment, it doesn't come from any food, it doesn't come from any social binding or any social group that you are in, because that will count as the flesh of samsara. While this niramisa, for example, the joy of meditation, the joy of seclusion that Banda is enjoying here in these circumstances, this is niramisa. It's a happiness not of this world.
Right. So if I'm to go back to explain the same thing, if in my social life I went to eat something and say, for instance, there was a pudding, caramel pudding for instance, and you got to serve yourself, the fun bit would have been to have served the bit that you liked. Yeah. Maybe some extra syrup. Yeah, and that brought happiness because you got to serve it. Today, as a monk, I still get served caramel pudding. I don't go to serve it, but my joy is to abstain from serving, wait and accept what somebody has dished out, and then to be able to consume it to sustain this self, and not for that greed I had and the fun I had in the past.
In the past.
Yeah. So, but pudding is still the pudding.
Yeah, yeah.
It's still in the same dish.
So the object is still the same.
Exactly. Yeah. So in this way, when you look at the totality of what that social world is about, it is still there. We as monks today engage with it with a different objective.
With a different attitude.
Exactly.
And purpose.
With a different purpose and with a different skill set. So therefore the happiness is not in that content, it is about the skillfulness contacting it. It is the skillfulness to maintain or the determination with that purpose that you have. So though we use the word happiness in the conventional world, it can't be brought here to be compared in the same way. Because this journey is to let go. And that journey is to gather. So in that journey, what you gathered and the way you measured happiness is different to the happiness that you have with letting go.
Hmm.
And not
true.
Yeah.
So, if I should say it very briefly, so in your lay life and in all lay life, there is some happiness. It can be small or it can be significant, connected with the world, with the samisa, connected with the flesh.
Yes,
samsaric happiness, huh? And this is not directly translatable to what happiness is in the monk life or in this recluse life out of this world, that is not connected with this world. No.
No.
However, I would say, from if I should chip in with my own experience, then I would say still that whatever happiness I have enjoyed in these 16 years being a monk, that was, if we should take this classification, niramisa, what was without the flesh, was without samsaric content, or with a lesser samsaric content than before. This has been much more pervasive and subtle than the excitement and the entertainment of that I had before in my lay life as a medical doctor with a family and friends.
Mm-hmm.
Why so? I think when there is excitement, there is some agitation. And so you will typically go to the cinema, or you go to a concert, or you go to a Tivoli or something like that to get some excitement and joy. So it's very intense, but it's also connected with unrest. While the thing you have experienced as a monk is also very intense, but it still has this taste of peace. Also because it's not connected with the world, it's not something that you go out in the world to experience. Actually, it's something that one seeks seclusion from the world to experience. So one cuts up every connection with samsara one's have to get this peace and this absence of agitation. And this satisfaction that you can find there, in my case, was much more profound and I would say much more meaningful and relevant and much more captivating than this small blitz of satisfaction I found while going to the cinema or going to some kind of enjoyment or entertainment in my lay life. So I think one can say it's not, you don't, people often look at monks and the monk life as saying, then I will lose something. But it should not be seen that it's true that one puts down something, for example, sexual pleasure, one puts this down, but then one gets something else that is much higher. So one swaps, so to speak, something low, something that is connected with unrest and agitation, for something that is much more intense and is connected with peace. And because of that, one gets this. So one gets for something that is higher, for something, for giving up something that is lower. And this one keeps doing all along the path. And this, I think, makes sense. It's a good economy. So it's not about skipping something or throwing something away without getting something that is have a higher level of quality on the other side. So I'm happy. I like to say thank you, Dabagavese. Yes. We came far around. Actually, I didn't speculate much about the question, but I think we have covered a lot of ground. So I also like to say thank you to you for your advantageous attention, for your clever consideration, and for your kind contribution. And may you indeed, by these words of the Dhamma here from Frederikssund in Denmark, a day in June, be peaceful and happy. Thank you.
Friends, what is this sublime right concentration? The Noble Eightfold Way leading to Nirvana is simply this. Right view, right motivation, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness, and right concentration. But what is right concentration? The Buddha explained the fourfold definition of right concentration exactly like this. Having eliminated the five mental hindrances, defects that obstruct understanding. While quite secluded from sensual desires, protected from any detrimental mental state, one enters and dwells in the first jhana, full of joy and pleasure, born of solitude, joined with directed and sustained thought. One makes this joy and pleasure, born of seclusion, drench, saturate, soak, and suffuse the entire body, so that no part of the body is unperfused by this intense joy and pleasure. Just as a skilled bathman puts soap powder in a copper basin and sprinkling it gradually with water, whips it until the water soaks and pervades all the soap powder, and making it into foam, yet without dripping, so too does a noble friend make the joy and pleasure born of solitude permeate and pervade this entire body. Again, friends, with the stilling of directed and sustained thought, one enters and dwells in the second jhana, a calm assurance of unification of mind, with even deeper joy and pleasure, now born of concentration, devoid of any thought. One makes this exquisite joy and pleasure, born of concentration, drench, saturate, soak, and suffuse the entire body, so that no part of the whole body is unperfused by this profound joy and pleasure. Just as a lake whose waters welled up below within itself, and it had no other source, neither by showers of rain nor from any river, then this cool fount of water welling up from deep within the lake itself would immerse, fill, and pervade the entire body. Even and exactly so does one make this joy and pleasure born of concentration infuse this entire body. Furthermore, friends, with the fading away of the joy, the noble friends dwells in even equanimity, just aware and clearly comprehending, still feeling pleasure in the body. One enters upon and remains in the third jhana, regarding which the noble ones declare, in aware equanimity, one dwells in pleasure. One makes this pleasure, apart from joy, flood, saturate, soak, and suffuse the body, so there's no part of one's whole body unperfused by this pleasure divested of joy. Just as in a lotus pond, some lotuses are born, grow, and thrive immersed under the water, and the cool water soaks them from their roots to their tips. So too does the noble friend make the pleasure divested of joy fill, flood, and pervade this entire body. Finally, friends, with the leaving behind of both pleasure and pain, and with the prior disappearance of both gladness and sadness, one enters and dwells in the fourth jhana, a completely still mental state of awareness, purified by equanimity of neither pain nor pleasure. One sits illuminating the body internally with his pure bright mind, so there is no part of one's whole body not illuminated by this pure, bright mind. Just as a man was sitting covered from the head down with a white cloth, so that no part of his whole body was uncovered by this white textile. Even so does one sit encompassing this entire body with a pure, bright, and radiant mind, so there's no part of one's whole body not illuminated by this pure, bright, and luminous mind. Needless to say, friends, no trivial worldly pleasure can ever surpass such sublime bliss. The function of right eye concentration and its associate is seeing right versus wrong concentration. As right versus wrong concentration is right view. Exchanging wrong concentration with right concentration is right effort. Right concentration functions as a drill, focusing, unifying, and penetrating. Concentration thus induces an intense breakthrough into the absolute. On how to attain the jhana absorption, search for jhana on whatbuddhasaid.net. And for further study on Buddhist right concentration, Samma Samadhi, the Siddhanas in Theravada Buddhist meditation, this wheel number 45.pdf. Or there is a path of purification, the complete manual on meditation and absorption. The path of purification, also free on whatbuddhasaid.net.